Over the past few years, I've built a number of different Raspberry Pi-based network-attached storage devices. I've built one using two mechanical drives and a Pi 4, a cheap Pi Zero-based NAS for under $35, and my latest was an all-SSD NAS on a Pi 5, which worked really well. But today we're going bigger, more practical, and much more like a traditional NAS. We're going to build a 4-bay NAS that uses 3.5-inch mechanical NAS drives in removable trays. It's still going to be powered by a Pi, and it'll look a lot more like a NAS that we're used to. On the hardware side, I'm again going to be using a Raspberry Pi 5, and we'll make use of its PCIe port and the Radser Penta SATA hat to get 4 SATA ports for our external drives. Technically it has a 5th port, but this is a different connector and it's on a different side of the hat, which makes it less easy to use with the others, so we'll stick with a 4-bay NAS. For storage, I've got 4 4TB WD-RED NAS drives. We'll then use these 4 SATA extension cables to plug them into the hat. You can plug 2.5-inch drives directly into the hat, but the spacing's too close together for 3.5-inch drives, so we'll need the extensions. I've gone with these ones because they've got mounting holes on the plugs, so I can design a bracket to hold them in the correct place for the drive trays. Then to finish it off, I've got a Pi 5 active cooler for the Pi CPU, a microSD card for the operating system, a 12-volt power adapter to provide power to the NAS, and a slim 80mm fan for cooling. Next, let's get the NAS enclosure designed, and for that I'm using Fusion 360. I designed a simple drive tray with a pull-out lever to insert and remove each drive. Behind the 4 drives is our Pi and Radser hat, and a simple rack to mount the 4 SATA cable ports to. These are hopefully in the right place, so that a drive slides into the NAS and plugs into these connectors without too much trouble. We don't need to access the Pi's USB-C or HDMI ports, as it's powered through the hat and will be running headless, so there isn't anything useful we'd be able to see on a monitor. We'll need to extend the power supply to the hat though, so I've added a small hole in the back for a barrel jack connector. Lastly, I've added the 80mm fan in above the Pi, and this will draw air in through the drive tray vents on the front of the NAS and out the back. I've also made up a small vented cover plate for the fan to prevent the drive cables from getting caught in the fan blades when we close it all up. The housing encloses the drives, Pi stack, cables and fan, and makes it look a lot like a traditional 4-bay NAS. To bring the modeled components to life, Bamboo Lab have sent me their P1S combo. This is one of their mid-range 3D printers, featuring a high-speed Core XY design with a fully enclosed build chamber, multi-material support using their AMS system, and out-of-the-box reliability that makes it perfect for functional prints like this. There's one problem with the model, and that's that with the Pi at the back, the whole assembly is now 275.5mm long, which is a little too long to 3D print in one go. The Bamboo Lab P1S has a maximum build volume of 256mm in each axis, which is quite large for a desktop printer, but it's not quite enough for the NAS. So rather than have a removable back or side panel to access the Pi, I've split the enclosure across a diagonal. This breaks it up into two pieces, but the seam will be hidden by the design accent, and this has the added benefit of not requiring any supports. In fact, this whole design doesn't require a single support to print it out. The split design also makes it easier to mount the Pi stack, fan, and cables internally. I sliced the model up in bamboo slicer across 6 build plates. I'll be using Bamboo Lab's PLA basic filament, and I'll use the AMS multi-material system to print the enclosure in black and to color the text in white on the front of the enclosure and on the drive tray levers. I used the presets for the textured PEI build plate, PLA basic filament, and the standard 0.2mm print profile. As you can see, we don't have any supports, and the model uses almost exactly one 1kg roll of filament. It's going to take just under 24 hours to print out all of the components, with the longest time obviously being spent on the front enclosure half. Because the text's all on the front, and it only takes up a couple of the initial layers, there's very little flashing waste too, only 5 grams of it. So let's get the components printed out. I haven't yet done a test print on the P1S. I just ran through their setup process, which has changed a bit since I got my original P1S, and I've run through their full auto-calibration routine, which took about 25 minutes to complete. So this 10-hour 2-material enclosure print is going to be its test print. One of the things I like about the AMS is that you don't land up with small rolls of leftover filament. You can load these into the AMS and it'll automatically switch over to the next roll of the same filament when it runs out. You don't even have to do anything, you'll just come back to an empty spool. The quality of the part straight off the printer with no setup or manual calibration is really impressive. There's no stringing or warping, and the tolerances on the trays and enclosure are spot on without any post-processing. It wasn't all smooth sailing though. I did have to reprint both of the enclosure halves because I forgot to add clearance to the front opening for the guards that I added to the drive trays, and I forgot to add the mounting holes for the pie in the back half. To assemble the enclosure, let's start out by adding M3 brass inserts to the parts that need to screw together, and we'll do that with a soldering iron. First we need to add 4 into the back half of the enclosure, which will be used to hold the two sections together. Then the SATA cable holder needs 4 to attach to the enclosure, and another 8 to hold the cable connectors. I might hold off on finishing those until I've got the cables installed, because the larger holes above each connector will help with installing the screws. The drive trays each get 1 insert for the screw that holds the lever in place. Now while the soldering iron's hot, let's finish off the cable holder. First let's add a drive cable to the holder with 2 M3x8mm button head screws. We can then use the open screw holes above it and a long hex key to tighten them up. I'm using the hex key that came with the P1S, which is just long enough to reach all the way through. Once that's done, we can add the next set of brass inserts, and then continue until we have all 4 cables installed. Next, let's get the drive trays loaded and the levers assembled. Each drive is held in the tray with 4 countersunk drive screws. Then another M3x8mm screw holds the lever in place with a 3D printed washer. The lever should be able to be rotated to the pull out or stowed positions. Again we repeat that for the other 3, so we have all 4 drive trays assembled. Next let's install the fan on the back of the enclosure. This is a slim 10mm fan, so it's held in place with 4 M3x16mm screws, and these go in through the back and through to the inner guard. Make sure that the fan's the right way around, so it's pushing air out the back of the case. I'm installing the guard with the slots horizontally, as the cables seem less likely to go into the fan in this orientation. I've made up a short barrel jack extension to provide power to the radser hat, which I'll install in the back too. Now we can get the pie stack assembled. I've preloaded PyOS Lite onto the microSD card, which we'll need for OMV, so we can slide that into the Pi's reader. Then let's install the active cooler. You'll need to remove 3 fins on the corner of the cooler's heatsink to clear the barrel jack on the radser hat. This is a bit of a design flaw with the hat that we'll need to work around. You can just break these off with the pliers, or you can cut them off with the rotary tool. Then add the standoffs that were supplied with the hat to the Pi with the threads facing upwards. We can then plug the hat's ribbon cable into the Pi's PCIe port and plug the hat into the GPIO pins and secure it to the top of the Pi. And that's the stack complete. I'm powering the fan from the Molex connector on the hat, and we'll need to plug in this power cable before installing the stack because there isn't enough clearance under the fan to plug it in afterwards. We can then install the stack in the back enclosure half, and it's held in place in the bottom with some M2.5 screws. Next, plug in the fan and power cable. And then we can plug in the SATA cables. The cable holder can then be installed in the enclosure, and is secured with 4 M3x8mm screws. Don't install it this way around, I'm doing it upside down, and I only realized this later on. It's supposed to go in this way around with the smaller data ports at the bottom. Make sure that there isn't too much stress on the hat connectors, and that the fan is free to turn. And that's the back half of the enclosure complete, so we're ready to close it up. The two halves slide together and are held in place with 4 more M3x8mm button head screws. If you don't like the look of the stainless steel screws, you can use black screws as an alternative. To finish it off, I'm going to add some tiny stick-on rubber feet to the bottom to help with vibration isolation when the drives are running. Now all that's left to do is to slide in the drives and it's ready to boot up. To boot it up, we need to plug in our Ethernet cable and our 12-volt power supply. Leave the NAS for a few minutes to boot up, and then we can try find its IP address. This can be done through our network's DHCP table, or using a utility like Angry IP Scanner. We can then SSH into the Pi using its IP address to continue setting it up. Let's start by making sure that the Pi is up to date. Now we need to install OMV on the Pi by running this command. The installation script takes about 5 minutes to complete, and should take you to a screen similar to this telling you that the Pi is rebooting and your SSH session will be terminated. Your Pi might also be given a new IP address, so if you can't reach it at the one you were using, recheck the DHCP table. Before opening up OMV to set up the software, we need to also enable the PCIe port on the Pi. This may be disabled by default, so none of the connected drives will show up until we edit the Pi's config file. Add this line to the config file, and then reboot the Pi again. We can then check that our hat is detected and is running at Gen 3 speeds. Now that we've got OMV installed and the PCIe port configured, we can access OMV's web dashboard through a browser on the same network by entering the Pi's IP address. The default login is admin and open Media Vault, which you'll want to change. Looking at disks, we can see our four drives showing up. There are loads of good guides on setting up OMV, so I'm not going to go through that here. I've set up my four drives in a RAID 5 configuration to balance storage capacity and redundancy, giving me a total usable storage capacity of 10.8 terabytes. I've then created a storage volume, a shared folder on the volume, and a user account to access it. So the NAS is now ready to do some testing. We can add the network location to our test PC. Copying a single large video file to the NAS, we get an average speed of around 110 megabytes per second, with some short dips along the way. This is around 900 megabits per second, which is likely saturating the gigabit Ethernet port on the Pi. And copying the large video file from the NAS is a little bit faster, and a bit more consistent too. We get an average speed of around 113 megabytes per second. Using an automated tester with a 1GB file, we get similar results too. Writes are around 100 megabytes per second and reads around 110. Because it looks like we're saturating the gigabit Ethernet ports on the Pi, like I did with my SSD NAS, I then tried plugging in a 2.5GB network adapter into one of the Pi's USB 3 ports. This improved writing to the NAS to an average of around 200 megabytes per second, again with a few dips. And copying the same file from the NAS to my PC, I got around 250 megabytes per second. So writing to the NAS is now likely being bottlenecked by the software RAID parity calculations being done by the Pi's CPU. This makes the 2.5GB network adapter an easy and worthwhile upgrade for less than $20. It makes a big difference to the NAS's performance, especially when large amounts of data are being transferred. I also tested power consumption. At idle, the NAS uses around 18 watts. And this goes up to a bit under 30 watts under load. This is quite a bit more than the 9 to 12 watts my SSD NAS used, but understandably so due to the more power-hungry mechanical drives. For comparison, my 4-bay Asus store NAS uses a similar 18 watts at idle, but that's with the drive spun down too, so this is a bit more efficient than that NAS. Thermally, the ventilation ports and fans seem to do quite well at keeping the Pi and drives cool. There are no visible hotspots, and the drive temperatures are good. The only real negative is that it's quite noisy because of the 80mm fan. It runs at just under 54 decibels, and there isn't an easy way to get it to turn off or ramp down under low loads. So that's my new 4-bay 3.5-inch Pi 5 NAS complete. Let me know what you think of it in the comments section below. I've put the 3D print files for the NAS up on MakerWorld. If you've got a Bamboo Lab 3D printer, then you can use the pre-configured print profiles I've uploaded and easily print out the components directly from the Bamboo Handy app on your phone. If you've been thinking about getting a 3D printer, the Bamboo Lab P1S is definitely worth taking a look at. It's a great entry point into high-speed multi-material printing, and the fully enclosed design makes it super versatile for printing everything from PLA to ABS, so you're not going to outgrow its capabilities. I'll leave a link to it and the filament used for this project in the video description too. If you do build your own Pi NAS, tag me on social media or leave a comment on MakerWorld or on my blog. I'd love to see your creations and additions. Thanks for watching. Please remember to like this video if you enjoyed it, and subscribe for more tech and electronics projects, tutorials, and reviews.